I'm very pleased that we have a most distinguished panel this morning here with experts who really know the region we are going to discuss about. And on the other hand, I'm a bit concerned that now for the second or third time when we discussed which countries or which regions to discuss many months ago, when it comes to the actual day we're discussing it, we're in the middle of a huge political crisis. So I'm a bit concerned for future events in future regions we're going to discuss. Hopefully this is not going to be a regular scenario.
The Kurdish region has developed, discovered and developed huge amounts of oil and is in the process of developing great amounts of gas. There is an estimated proven oil reserves of 45 billion barrels. That is world rank 10, just for the pretty small Kurdish region.
Margaret, and above all, Kurdistan has borders with Europe, if you look at it that way, if you can. You know, Turkey is one of European or EU countries. It has borders with Europe within a few thousand miles. It can be in Kurdish gas can be in Bangkok. I'm not under any illusion that Kurdish gas is not going to be in the European market tomorrow, but within the next 10, 15 years, it's very possible.
What has developed in Kurdistan, this oil and gas, has been also a blessing for my country to develop relations between Kurdistan and Turkey. We opened our first embassy. Our first ambassador is with us only four and a half years ago. And now, where we are economically, you know, the economical ties between Kurdistan and Turkey is there is a trade of over $12 billion from Turkey to Kurdistan, which is second to Germany in the country.
From the standpoint of the U.S. government, in the last year, the Obama administration has had to take stock of three challenges in the East China Sea, in Ukraine, and now in Iraq. We sit here today, not far from Trafalgar Square, in the capital of the country that defended the international system, the Westphalian system, from the attempt of Napoleon to overturn it for an imperial nationalistic scheme, and which then put together rules of the road internationally for much of trade and commerce that the United States has done its best to support the last 100 years. This is being challenged in all three of these areas, including by claims to history, claims to one's people next door. That's one of the arguments the Iranians are making with Iraq right now. Those are Shia that are being slaughtered in those horrible videos, and we reserve the right to protect Shia any place.
And some say, well, actually, de facto is already being changed. Maybe not de jure, but when you look at Iraq and Syria and zoom in, you see in Iraq four different areas under different control. You see the Kurdistan regional government acting as if it is an own nation state. You see the central government of Iraq, which is basically an Iran-backed kind of Shia majority government in that central part of the country. Then you look at the Shia provinces in the south, the oil-rich provinces of the south, which actually makes also an effort to gain more regional and budgetary rights in Iraq. And then you look at the western area of Iraq, which is under the control of ISIS.
Let me thank all the speakers for coming here. Jim from the United States, everybody from far away, have a good day, and let's hope all together that things in Iraq calm down, that we have peace soon, and let us wish all the politicians well who have lots of responsibility these days to create a peaceful solution. Thank you very much.